look at this gospel this week, it reminded me of the Victor Hugo novel, Les Miserables, the part when Jean Valjean first gets out of prison. After years of harsh treatment in the prison system, he was cold, hungry, and desperate. Yet no one wanted anything to do with him. He was turned away from inn after inn. They even refused to keep him in the prison overnight. Finally, in desperation, he burst in through the door of a kindly old priest and begged for a meal and a place to sleep out of the cold. The priest, he treated him with the same respect he would treat any guests, served him a warm meal on his best silver, and showed him to a warm bed for the night. Jean Valjean was at first incredulous of the priest's kindness. But as the night wore on, he began to think more and more about what would happen the next day and how he would again be in that same desperate situation. If only there was a way he could get a little money and move away to a place where no one would know him. He remembered seeing the silver being put in the closet at the end of last evening's meal. So after everyone was well asleep, he snuck into the pantry, took the silver, and fled the house. In the morning, the theft was discovered and the whole household was in a dither, except for the old priest. The old priest said, "Well, you know, we really don't need silver to dip a piece of bread into a cup of broth." A couple hours later, the police showed up at the house with Jean Valjean in their grasp and the stolen silver in their hands. "We believe these belong to you," they said. "And we caught this villain trying to run off with them." The old priest replied, "Oh, this is all a misunderstanding. Jean Valjean, my friend, why did you leave so early before breakfast? And you forgot to take with you the candlesticks that I gave you." And at that, he brought two very expensive candlesticks from the same closet and handed them to the thief. Everyone was so taken aback that no one could say anything. The police do nothing but release the man, and as for Jean Valjean, we see that with the money from the silver and the candlesticks, he was able to go to a place where he was not known, take on a new identity, and go on to live a prosperous and successful new life. You know, I think if we had been in that same room, we would have been just as taken aback as the others. The act of that old priest was so far beyond what anyone could ever ask of. And yet, that is exactly what Jesus is telling us to do today. I don't know if any of us can fully comprehend how absolutely radical this teaching is. He's telling us not only not to strike back when we are slapped on the cheek, but to actually offer our other side, not only to passively accept a forced walk of a mile, but to volunteer to walk for a second mile. That's just not the way of the world, is it? We are taught to hold on to our own, even to fight for what we have if necessary. We are taught that when someone does us a wrong, there is a need for payback. An eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But is that really what we mean? Or do we mean, this person hurt me, embarrassed me in front of my friends. I'm going to make sure he knows how it feels. I'll embarrass him so badly that he'll never be able to show his face again. We go beyond an eye for an eye. We go to maybe two eyes for an eye, or maybe a nose and an eye for an eye. We want to fix it so we will never be hurt like that again. And how is that person going to respond to what we do? The same way. It goes on and on until one of us is so broken and so beat that we no longer are able to fight back. Jesus offers us another way. He asks us to respond with generosity and compassion rather than anger and self-pride. A good friend of mine once offered me this advice. She said, when someone does something that irritates you, that makes you angry, or even that hurts you, say to yourself the words, "Bless them and change me." Bless them. God be with them as they try to fulfill whatever plan that God has formed for them to do, and heal whatever it is within them that impels them to deviate from that plan. And change me, not to be more like them, but rather to be open to both the good and the bad that come into my life, and help me to develop that meekness and that humbleness of heart which Jesus, during his life here on earth, so perfectly imaged for us. Change me with your grace, that I may always carry within me that generosity of spirit that allows me to be willing to forgive those who hurt me. Change me with your grace so that compassion and mercy can become the driving force within me, and lead me to see the presence of God within everyone that I encounter. Change me with your grace that I can be perfect, just as your Heavenly Father is perfect. But of course, his perfection doesn't come all at once, and it's not easy. That perfection is a grace given to us, but it's a gift that needs to be nourished and developed. So when the person in the checkout line in front of you has already gone through 3 credit cards and still has to return some of the items, check your impatience and say, "Bless them and change me." When someone scolds and embarrasses you in front of others, don't try to think of some angry or clever retort. Say instead, "Bless them, change me." When someone tries to lord it over everybody else and acts as though nothing good can happen without it, don't try to find ways to put him in his place. Say, "Bless him, change me." If we can find ways to practice this humility and generosity of spirit in those little hurts in life, we may find within us the grace to forgive and to move past those deeper hurts, those life-altering hurts that come to us, and perhaps even to find joy and sharing in the suffering of Jesus. We find the same teaching in Luke's Gospel, but in Luke's Gospel, the words are changed just a little. Instead of being perfect as the Father is perfect, he invites us to be merciful as the Father is merciful. You know, that old priest in Victor Hugo's story has attained to the perfection which Jesus calls us. For to God, perfection isn't measured by what we are able to accomplish, but rather by the generosity of spirit, the compassion and mercy that we use, and the accomplishing.